A very good morning, my dear students. May this day bring new opportunities and success for you. So rise and shine. Today we are going to continue with the lecture that is the development of the embryonic disc. We have to cover these topics: the notochord formation, neural tube, intraembryonic mesoderm, the yolk sac and folding of embryo. Do you remember this diagram? Yes, we already know this diagram. This diagram is showing you the two layers, columnar and cubical. This is the epiblast, hypoblast. You remember the layers? Then is the formation of the splanchnopleuric and somatopleuric extraembryonic mesoderm after the appearance of the extra embryonic coelom. Here is the future connecting stalk, the amniotic cavity and the secondary yolk sac, you already know. So this diagram is a must know diagram and you are well aware with this. Very good. And you also know this diagram. This is the diagram of the embryonic disc. Before the appearance of the central axis, the two layers, the columnar and the cubical endoderm, columnar ectoderm and cubical endoderm. Then when there is the formation of the head end and tail end by the procaudal plate, yes, few cells in the cubical endoderm, they become columnar and they form the procaudal plate, and this establishes the head end and the tail end. Now what happens at the tail end? This also we know. There is the proliferation of the ectodermal cells. Primitive streak is formed. Yes. Now we know this. Let's start something new. So this is the diagram we know. Cranially is the buccopharyngeal membrane. Caudally is the cloacal membrane. There is a primitive streak. Now the primitive streak's cranial end is thickened and it forms a node, and that is known as the primitive node. The other names are primitive knot, primitive streak or Hansen's node. These are the names of the thickenings which are present at the cranial end of the primitive streak. And one more thing you can see over here, there's a depression in the center and that is known as the blastopore. Now notochord. What is a notochord? A notochord is a primitive beginning to the backbone. It is composed of stiffer tissue and it allows for skeletal support of the organism. It appears in embryos as a small flexible rod which is made up from cells from the mesoderm. So this is the introduction of notochord. There is a process which is known as notochordal process or the head process. What is this process? There is the cranial movement of cells from primitive knot to the caudal margin of procaudal plate. There is a cranial movement of cells from the primitive knot to the caudal margin of the procaudal plate. You remember this procaudal plate, and this cells they migrate from the which portion? From cranially to caudal, that is to the procaudal plate's caudal area it reaches, and this is known as the notochordal process. The cells move. Now cells then undergo certain changes and they form a solid rod, and that is known as notochord, and it is present in the midline. Is it okay? Notochordal process or head process is nothing but the movement of cells from the primitive knot to the caudal margin of the procaudal plate. But my dear students, things are not that simple. There are certain sequence, there is a sequence for that. And what is the sequence of notochord formation? The first step is, there is the formation of notochordal canal. Notochordal canal. And this is formed in the cavity of the blastopore. Blastopore, we have seen, a cavity is formed in the blastopore which extends in the notochordal process. Notochordal process we know, and a cavity extends into that from the blastopore. And this cavity converts it into a notochordal canal. A canal is formed. Okay. Then what happens? When a canal is formed, canal has a roof and a floor. The cells which form the floor, it gets mixed up with the cells of the endoderm and they separate the canal from the yolk sac. Just have a look on this diagram. We talked about primitive streak. We talked about procaudal plate and the primitive knot. Yes. In the primitive knot, there is depression known as blastopore. A cavity is formed. A cavity is formed in the blastopore. And here is the notochordal process, where is a migration of cells from the primitive streak to the procaudal plate. This much we know. Then the cavity is formed from the blastopore and this cavity is extending into the notochord and it has converted it into a canal and this canal is known as notochordal canal. Is it fine? Yes. Then what happens next? The cavity is formed in the notochord and notochordal canal is formed. This is the floor, here is the roof. Floor, roof. This floor breaks and it communicates with the yolk sac. The floor breaks and it communicates with the yolk sac. Then also it communicates with the amniotic cavity through the blastopore. It means there is a communicating thing now. The three things are communicating, that is the canal, the amniotic cavity and the yolk sac. Okay, we can see the other slide. You can see over here, there's a notochordal, and this is the endoderm, ectoderm, and it is incorporated, interconnected in the embryonic endoderm. Yes, when there is communication between the two, that is the amniotic cavity and the yolk sac, because of the floor is now more, floor is no more, right? A floor is no more. So there's a communication between the amniotic cavity and the yolk sac, and this communication is through the blastopore, and the canal is known as the neuroenteric canal. This much is clear. After the establishment of the communication, which is a transient phase, the walls of the canal flatten again and they form a plate that is known as the notochordal plate. This plate is again curved and the tube is formed of the solid, now the rod, solid rod of cells is formed, and this is the definitive notochord. After the communication is established, then the canal flattens and forms a plate, and that is known as the notochordal plate. And this plate is again curved, and the tube is formed of solid rod of cells, and that is a definitive notochord. We can see the summary once again. The first thing is the notochordal process, and you very well know this is the ectoderm and the endoderm. Then what happens? There is a formation of the notochordal canal over here. It incorporates into the endoderm, the floor breaks, so the communication is established, only the roof is left. Then there is incorporation of this part of the notochord into the endoderm and forms a plate. But the thing don't stop here, this again makes a curve and now it forms the definitive notochord. Yes. This diagram is taken from your books, and I think it is easy to understand now. There is one more slide we can see how the folding takes place. This again, the notochordal plate is formed, which was we saw this slide earlier also. The notochordal plate is there, which is the embryonic endoderm. It folds, and then now the definitive notochord is formed. And side by side, you can see also that in the ectoderm, there is some groove formation, and that is a neural groove formation. And also you can see over here, the formation of the definitive notochord, there is a formation of mesoderm also. We'll study this thing later. Don't think about that right now. Just concentrate on the notochord. And a groove, that is a neural groove. But what is the fate of notochord? Does it stay forever? No, it actually degenerates and it disappears as the bodies of the vertebrae dwell. And it just forms the intervertebral discs. You can see this is the vertebral column, and in between is the disc. So the part which lies between the vertebral bodies, it persists as nucleus pulposus of each intervertebral discs. But sometimes the remnants of notochord tissue are there. It can give rise to certain tumors, and these tumors are known as chordomas. So you can see the vertebral bodies, and in between is a disc, and here is the nucleus pulposus, that is a remnant of the notochord. So what is the function of notochord then? The functions of notochord is, it defines, number one, it defines primordial axis of the embryo. It gives rigidity to the embryo. It serves as a basis for the development of the axial skeleton. It indicates a future site of the vertebral bodies or column. So future site is determined by notochord itself. And it also regulates differentiation of surrounding structures, including the overlying ectoderm and the mesoderm. Okay, so these are the functions of notochord, the development and the fate of notochord. I hope the notochord formation is clear to you. The next is the neural tube. What is neural tube? Neural tube is the embryonic structure that has to form brain and spinal cord. And the process by which neural tube is formed is known as neurulation. And it is formed from ectoderm. And it extends from the prochordal plate to the primitive knot. It has two parts. The cranial part gives rise to brain, and the caudal part gives rise to spinal cord. You can see in this slide over here the formation of the brain. Forebrain, midbrain, hindbrain, prosencephalon, mesencephalon, rhombencephalon. And then is the spinal cord. So this is by the formation of neural tube. It gives rise to the brain and the spinal cord. And what are the stages? The stages of neurulation include the formation of the neural plate, neural groove, and their neural folds, and their fusion is there. Also the neural crest cells are formed. Neural tube is there, which finally gives rise to brain in the spinal cord, and begins during early part of the fourth week and ends by the end of fourth week. And we saw in the early diagram also, there was a groove. When the notochord formation was there, there was a groove in the ectoderm, and so the neurulation is induced by notochord. Let's see the slide diagram now. This is the notochord, and this is the ectoderm, mesoderm and endoderm, and we can see the folding in the ectoderm, and then the neural groove is formed. This neural groove now closes, and finally the neural tube is formed. One more slide. This is the notochord, the ectoderm in which there is the neural plate formation is there. The groove is formed. This plate forms the groove, and finally the it groove closes. Above that is the neural crest cells, and you can see the neural tube formation is there. But if there is any abnormality anywhere, defect anywhere, so it can result in certain diseases, certain conditions, and these are like, for example, spina bifida, which can be open or close. There can be anencephaly, and there are other conditions also which are related with the neural tube defects. You can see the slide in which the neural tube defects are there, and the operative procedure is required. So this is about the neural tube. Then we come to intraembryonic mesoderm, how it is formed. Remember the epiblast cells, they migrate through the primitive streak between the epiblast and hypoblast layers. Remember the two layers in that diagram we talked about, and the epiblast cells, they migrate through that and they form an intermediate layer, and that is known as intraembryonic mesoderm. Here is the diagram we can see over here. This diagram, we already know this well, amniotic cavity, secondary yolk sac. Here is the ectoderm, here is the endoderm, and the cells from the ectoderm, they migrate, yes, and they form a mesoderm, that is known as the intraembryonic mesoderm. You can see the migration from the primitive streak. The mesoderm is not present where? At two areas, where the buccopharyngeal membrane is formed, that is the future mouth, and at the cloacal end. Okay, we can see even another diagram, that is the primitive node and pit. You can see over here, this is the primitive streak, the node, and there is the formation of the, there is the movement of the cells from the ectoderm, and they form the mesoderm, and the mesoderm is known as the intraembryonic mesoderm. Yes, all good, very good. What about this intraembryonic mesoderm? Again, you can see the lateral movement from the primitive streak, and this form the intraembryonic mesoderm. See the epiblast cells, they form the primitive streak, and the newly formed cells, they migrate ventrally and laterally and cranially also, okay, at the margins of the embryonic disc. The intraembryonic mesoderm merges with the extraembryonic mesoderm. You can see over here, this is the intraembryonic mesoderm, and at the margin it merges with the extraembryonic mesoderm. We can see another diagram also. Amniotic cavity, yolk sac, notochord, and this is the formation of the intraembryonic mesoderm, and it is in communication, it merges with the extraembryonic mesoderm. What about this intraembryonic mesoderm? It has to differentiate into three types. And in fact, it is induced by notochord, and it differentiates into paraxial mesoderm, intermediate cell mass, and the lateral plate mesoderm. See what we are talking about? That after the formation of this intraembryonic mesoderm, it has to differentiate, and it differentiates into three types. This is notochord, and immediately adjacent to the notochord is the paraxial mesoderm, then is the intermediate cell mass, and then is the lateral plate mesoderm, which merges with the extraembryonic mesoderm. Okay, the three types, the three differentiating feature cells of the this intraembryonic mesoderm. Okay. Yes, if we see this slide, remember this primitive streak, remember this primitive node, the buccopharyngeal membrane, the cloacal membrane. Then the three types of the intra-embryonic meristem are, which are near the notochord, adjacent to the notochord, is the paraxial meristem. Then is the intermediate meristem, and then is the lateral plate meristem. These three types are formed. Another slide. Notochord. Above is the meiotic cavity. Below is the secondary yolk sac now, and here is the intra-embryonic meristem, and outside is the extra-embryonic meristem. And this meristem is paraxial, intermediate, and lateral meristem. To be more specific, we can see very easy things. The neural groove above the notochord, and here lies the meristem. There is one new word written over here, that is the somite, intermediate, and lateral plate. What is somite? We'll just deal with it within few minutes. First of all, yes, the paraxial meristem. Yes, we are here. But this type of meristem is segmented meristem. Segmented meristem. And here are the presence of somatomeres. They form the bones and muscles of the head. And they are about 7 in number. And the somites, they are cubical and they are segmented. The occipital is most cranial. There are about 44 pairs of the somites. Okay, so paraxial is segmented. We can see the diagram. This is a diagram, a very easy to draw diagram. If you get a question on somites or intra-embryonic meristem, you can draw this diagram. Very easy to draw also. What is this? Yes, yes, you are right. The procaudal plate. Below is the cloacal membrane. Here is the notochord. Then is the paraxial meristem. Yes, paraxial meristem, which is segmented. You can see the segments. Yes, like earthworm. So it is segmented. After that is the intermediate. This bluish is the intermediate meristem or intermediate mass. And then is the lateral plate meristem. Lateral plate meristem. And what else we can see over here is that in the lateral plate meristem, there is a formation of a cavity which gives rise to various important structures. Like this is for the cardiogenic area over here, and here is a pericardium. Pericardium means that is a area which covers the heart. Okay, then for the pleura, which covers the lungs, then the peritoneal canal, and the unsplit part is the septum transversum. Okay, let's see the intermediate meristem. This intermediate meristem, it connects the paraxial and lateral meristem. Then finally afterwards, it develops the excretory units of the urogenital system. This is the function of the intermediate meristem. We can see over here, this is the notochord. Over here, neural tube. Here lies the paraxial meristem, we just discussed, and this is the intermediate meristem, the lateral plate meristem. Intermediate meristem gives rise to the urogenital system, that is the kidney and the gonads. Now we'll study about the lateral plate meristem. Regarding the lateral plate meristem, this lateral plate meristem splits into two layers: somatopleuric, that is a parietal; splanchnopleuric, that is a visceral. Now the somatopleuric layer forms the future body wall, while the splanchnopleuric layer forms the circulatory system. We can see the diagram now. Time for the diagram. Here is the neural tube. Here is the paraxial meristem, which is segmented, somites. Here is the intermediate meristem, which forms what? Yes, genital urinary system. And is the here is the lateral peritoneum, which has divided in which is divided into two main divisions are somatic and splanchnic. Somatic forms the body wall, while splanchnic layer forms the circulatory system, the lymphatic system. Splanchnic, somatic. This is somatic. This is splanchnic. Somatic, splanchnic. Somatic, splanchnic. Okay. So if we just summarize the three types of intra-embryonic mesoderms, what are their functions, or what are their, yes, what do they do, what do they form, what are their derivatives? So here is the, first of all, this is the notochord formation is there, okay. Here is the paraxial mesoderm on both the sides. It forms head and somites. Somites further forms sclerotome, myotome, dermatome, that is the cartilages, skeletal muscles, and the skin is formed by the paraxial mesoderm. The intermediate cell mass we know now forms kidney and the gonads, genitourinary system. While the lateral peritoneal mesoderm, it forms the circulatory system, the body cavities, and extra embryonic structures. The main is the body cavities and the circulatory system. Hope you are with me, everything is good. Yes. Then is the intraembryonic coelom. Very easy to understand. It is a horseshoe-shaped coelom in the lateral plate mesoderm. A horseshoe-shaped coelom in the lateral plate mesoderm, and it communicates with the extraembryonic coelom. It gives rise to, we just saw, pericardial, pleural, and peritoneal membranes. And the unsplit part forms the septum transversum, and forms the diaphragm and the ligaments of liver. We have studied diaphragm, we've already studied the ligaments of liver. Clear. Thank you. So the last topic now, first of all the diagram first. Yes. This is a diagram showing you the neural plate. Okay. This is the paraxial mesoderm, which is segmented, the somites. The procaudal plate and the cloacal membrane, you know this. Here is a primitive streak, and you can also see the coelom, and the unsplit part is future septum transversum. Here lies the future pericardial cavity and the pleural cavity in the peritoneal structures, peritoneal canal. Okay, now we come to the last part, that is the formation of yolk sac and the folding of embryo. That is how the embryo is formed. There are head and tail folds. There is a formation of the primitive gut, that is the foregut, midgut, and hindgut. Also, there is a formation of the definitive yolk sac, that is the umbilical vesicle. There is a vitro-intestinal duct, also known as Whiteland duct, also known as yolk stalk, or omphalomesenteric duct. This has to disappear, and umbilical opening is formed, which is a circular aperture through which this duct passes. Let's see the diagram. This is a very familiar diagram by now, the amniotic cavity and the yolk sac. There is the folding of the yolk sac. You can see we are seeing in the XY axis, and you can see the folding over here. Amniotic cavity is above, okay. There is a formation of the head fold and the tail fold, head fold and the tail fold. And by this, there is the division into three types, that is the foregut, midgut, and hindgut. And this is the vitreo-intestinal duct, the passage. And the yolk sac becomes very small, and that is known as the definitive yolk sac. This diagram is from your book itself. One more diagram we can see over here. That is how the establishment of head and tail end takes place. Yes. This is the amniotic cavity, the yolk sac. Okay. The dotted circles show the buccopharyngeal and the cloacal membranes, the future excretory system, the future mouth. Here is the formation of the brain, and the neural tube is there. In front we can see the pericardial cavity and a cardiogenic mesenchyme. The unsplit part is a septum transversum. Okay. What else you can see? Notochord, you know, and that's it. That is the formation of the head end and the tail end. How the umbilical cord is formed now after the formation of the head and tail? Again, the same diagram, the amniotic cavity and the yolk sac. The trophoblast is still there. Here is the extramyonic mesoderm. You can see the area where the mesoderm is unsplit. That is the connecting, that forms the connecting stalk. The coelom is formed over all over here, except in this area, which forms the connecting stalk. And then what happens? The connecting stalk is the area for the formation of the placenta. Placenta, yes, placenta is formed. Then what happens? This is the futile umbilical cord, and this vitelline duct then disappears. An umbilical cord is formed, which attaches to the placenta. Okay. The umbilical cord is formed like this. One more easy diagram to understand now. The amniotic cavity, that is just the embryonic disc and the little structures before the formation of the head and tail end. That is the amniotic cavity and the yolk sac. You know this. Septum transversum, the pericardial cavity, the heart tubes are there. This is the procaudal plate, the neural plate, and you can see over here the primitive streak. And at the tail end is the cloacal membrane. The allantoic diverticulum is for the excretory system. You will study later when this, you will study the development of urinary bladder. So this is the how the thing works. So you can see the more development. You can see the yolk sac now. The size is smaller. Again, the formation of the buccopharyngeal membrane. The foregut is over here. And you can see the pericardial cavity and the heart tube formation. And you can see the position. It has become more on the anterior aspect. And the buccopharyngeal membrane is going to be more cranial, and it is going to form the future mouth. What happens, what about the umbilical cord then? In the umbilical cord, there are two arteries, the two umbilical arteries, okay, over here, and one umbilical vein, and here are the remnants of the vitreo-intestinal duct and the remnants of the allantois. Yes, hope the lecture is clear to you. Any query, anytime, most welcome. Thank you and good luck. Bye-bye.